When it comes to sexual misconduct, there are some common beliefs we all tend to share. We seem to think that all offenders are strangers. We also seem to think that sexual misconduct can only happen in very isolated places and by threatening, menacing-looking people. This would mean that sexual misconduct would never happen in a religious environment or by people we trust, right?
Wrong. These are all common misconceptions about sexual misconduct. The truth is, in most cases, the offender is not a stranger. It is most often a person the victim has known and trusted for a long period of time. And the actual incidents of sexual misconduct can happen in public places, even in places where you think you're safe from harm. Unfortunately, this means our religious institutions and places of worship are not immune.
Hi, my name is Jim Codrington.
And I'm Stephanie Belding with the Anglican Church of Canada. This video has been designed to help all religious denominations learn more about the type of sexual misconduct that can occur in their community and learn how to prevent it.
By learning how to spot sexual misconduct, we can stop it and work towards creating safer places for all of God's people.
Churches, synagogues, temples, all places of worship play many roles in people's lives. One important role is to provide a place of sanctuary, a place of worship and trust where they will not come to harm. Some of the people seeking sanctuary are fragile and confused. They look to their place of worship for help and guidance. How can we make sure the people that come into our communities, especially the most vulnerable, are protected from sexual misconduct?
An important part of preventing sexual misconduct is understanding exactly what it is and learning how to spot it. Sexual misconduct is actually a general term we use to describe three types of unacceptable behavior: sexual harassment, sexual exploitation, and sexual assault.
Sexual harassment is a violation of federal, provincial, and territorial human rights codes. All organizations have a responsibility to provide employees and volunteers with an environment that is free from sexual harassment. In legal terms, sexual harassment is most often defined as a sexual course of comment or conduct that is known, or ought reasonably to be known, to be unwelcome. Examples of sexual harassment are sexually suggestive remarks or jokes, unwelcome sexual innuendos or invitations, leering and other sexual gestures, inappropriate physical contact, and the display of sexually explicit material. It's really any behavior or comments of a sexual nature that intimidate, humiliate, or demean another person. Sometimes people truly do not intend to hurt anyone by a joke or a remark or by a hug or a pat on the behind, but their actions can still constitute sexual harassment. That's because it's not the intent that matters. It's the effect it has on the other person.
Another form of sexual misconduct is sexual exploitation. That's when someone takes advantage of a position of power or authority they have over another person. Just like doctors, social workers, and others in helping professions, religious leaders must avoid potentially conflicting obligations and responsibilities to the people to whom they are ministering. That means that even if two single adults agree to a sexual relationship, it is inappropriate and exploitative if one has a professional relationship towards the other. That's because one has more control over the relationship than the other. Sexual exploitation is any form of sexual contact or invitation to sexual contact by a person in a position of power or authority, whether or not the individual gives consent.
The third type of sexual misconduct is sexual assault. It is defined as criminal in the Criminal Code of Canada. Sexual assault involves any behavior where there is no consent to the sexual activity, or the victim does not resist due to force, fear, or threats. This also includes any sexual offense against children and young people. Sexual assault of children is so serious that everyone in society is responsible for reporting any suspected child abuse to the authorities. In fact, all professionals, including ordained and lay religious leaders, are legislated under the provincial and territorial child protection laws to report any suspected child abuse to the child protection authorities or to the police. If you are not sure if you should make a report, you can call your local Child Protection Services or the Children's Aid Society to discuss the situation.
Even though we know the definitions of the three types of sexual misconduct, sexual harassment, sexual exploitation, and sexual assault, these types of behavior are not always that easy to spot in real life. We're going to show you some real-life scenarios that will help you spot the potential for sexual misconduct and learn how to deal with these situations.
Hi there, what's your name?
I'm Christopher.
Hi Christopher, I'm Michael. I'll be doing the servant training this evening. Well, why don't you have a seat there and we're just gonna wait for the others to show up.
Okay.
All right. Great.
The first scenario involves children. This child is alone with one adult in an unsupervised situation. Although the church is a public place that is usually filled with lots of people, at this time it's an empty space and the child is clearly uncomfortable. This has the potential for a harmful situation because people who sexually abuse children look for opportunities to get children alone. What could be done immediately to minimize the risk of danger to the child?
Listen, Christopher, it doesn't seem like anyone else is showing up this evening, so I think we're just going to do this possibly some other time. Is there anyone that can pick you up?
Yeah, my dad's picking me up.
Your dad?
Mm-hmm.
Would you like to use my phone to call him?
Yes.
Okay, yeah. There you are.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I'll just walk you out. Normally, when I do these functions, there's usually more than at least three or four kids all together. And this evening, I waited more than 10, 15 minutes, and I just, no one else showed up, and it made me feel very uncomfortable. I think if we possibly could get our hands on another trainer would be better. Just sort of create an environment where there was more than one person. One of the things I noticed in here is it's very dark and quite gloomy. I feel possibly next time I would like to talk to the pastor and possibly get some more lighting, just to open up, get some more brightness in here. Well, I felt I did what was necessary, and that was to ask if anyone could pick him up. I certainly didn't feel like going ahead with the night's schedule.
Fortunately, this man realized it was not appropriate for him to be alone with one child in an isolated space. He canceled the class and phoned the parents right away. He should also tell his minister about the incident and possibly even document it. What policies or procedures could be put in place to ensure this type of situation doesn't occur again? One way to help prevent sexual abuse of children is to ensure that a child is never alone with one adult in an isolated space, even in situations that seem as harmless as server training. Clergy and church wardens should also make a habit of randomly visiting the different groups and events that take place in the church community. Parents should also be invited to drop by without notice, and all Sunday school and youth group rooms should be easily accessible for viewing.
Now let's look at a situation involving two adults.
I feel like we have something more than just you counseling me. I think we've moved beyond that, and I'd like to kind of get to know you better and just kind of move beyond the sort of counselor client relationship.
By ministering to the woman and helping her with her spiritual needs during her divorce, the minister has given important support at a time when the woman is especially vulnerable. Since these two have a relationship that has become closer over the years, there's been a gradual breakdown of the appropriate boundaries for a pastoral relationship between the woman and her minister. Now the woman is taking the initiative to move the relationship towards something more intimate. But since she has become dependent on the minister, she can't really give free consent to this relationship. It would be sexual exploitation on the part of the minister to allow this relationship to become intimate. This would be a serious violation of his role as her minister. What could be done immediately to stop this from becoming sexual exploitation?
I've noticed, at least over the last four or five sessions, that there has been sort of something that you've wanted to discuss. I've sensed something, and I'm glad that you just put it on the table here. But it's a responsibility on my part to remember that I'm the one that is the counselor, that you came to me for help, and that whatever we discuss here is, of course, very personal and confidential to you, but we really need to acknowledge that any more counseling between you and I would certainly be inappropriate at this stage. There's a whole transference that's going on here, both from a bad relationship to finding a certain comfort in a counseling situation. I really think that it would be best if we took a look at some of the other options that are available to you here. And maybe I could arrange to introduce you to a couple of my colleagues and see whether they would be able to meet with you and help you take the next step, certainly, but maybe take the next step in a somewhat different direction. How would you feel about that? I realized right away that it was my responsibility as the person providing the counseling to really work very hard not to violate her trust and not to injure her self-esteem, but to make sure that she understood that the counseling relationship had to end. And I didn't want to say end so much as I said it had to evolve outside of the parameter we'd set to another counselor who could help her take, as she put it, that very next step. And I think that really is, as I said before, my responsibility. So we've done that, and I think it's made a big change.
In this scenario, the minister acknowledged that he valued the woman, but knew that it would be a violation of his pastoral relationship if he crossed the line and started a sexual relationship with her. He clearly and sensitively told the woman the boundaries of their relationship and offered to find her an appropriate counselor. If he did want to pursue an intimate relationship with a woman, the very least he should do is wait a period of 2 years and make sure she joins another congregation. In either situation, he should speak with an authority in his denomination. Relationships between religious leaders and their congregations are complex, usually because they are very familiar, intimate, and emotional. Therefore, religious leaders need to be extra vigilant and always make sure the boundaries are clear in all relationships. What policies or procedures could be put in place to ensure sexual exploitation does not occur? Always document pastoral counseling meetings and involve your supervisor in the progress of the individual. Hold sessions in your office or in a specific counseling area with a window. If possible, have someone else nearby. Remember, you need to ensure confidentiality, but this does not involve appearing secretive. If the individual continues to need help after 6 or 7 sessions, refer him or her to a professional counselor. They may need help beyond the spiritual guidance you can give.
Now let's look at an example of sexual harassment.
Hey, how many people are out today?
I think there's like 100 or so. Oh, no. I know there's a lot of people I've got to get things ready for.
You'll never get there in time.
Well, how about I'll keep doing
this.
And you can do that. Carve that up if you want.
Sarah,
what?
You know why women are like chickens?
Why?
All breasts and thighs.
Oh.
Frank may not mean to offend Sarah, but it's not the intention that makes a situation sexual harassment. It's the effect his jokes have on Sarah. Sarah is offended by the joke, but doesn't seem to be able to tell him to stop. The person who overhears this realizes the effect Frank's jokes are having on Sarah. What could be done immediately to stop this form of sexual harassment?
Well, you know, I overheard Frank make a joke, and that's usually Frank, maybe just to, you know, be more comfortable. But I realized after he did tell the joke that it was not appropriate. I thought I'd talk with him, and I thought that I would talk to the minister, or at least have Frank talk with the minister about it. I think this is the first time that he has had that kind of a response, so I know that he thinks he has to change something.
The person must be told his behavior is having a harmful effect on another person and asked to stop. If that doesn't work, the matter should be reported to a person in authority. And the offense doesn't need to happen to you for you to report it. Often when we see situations like these, we think we shouldn't get involved, that it's none of our business. But sexual harassment is everyone's business. Like Sarah, some people find it hard to speak up. If the other volunteer didn't get involved, the situation may have continued.
I guess I was trying to make a joke. And she was busy here. And I saw these chickens and I thought, well, just say something funny. And it wasn't meant in any bad way. I didn't mean it. I didn't realize I was saying something that was inappropriate. And then she looked at me, and I could see something wrong. All of a sudden, you know, there was something wrong, and I didn't know what to do. But I didn't mean anything by it. And how can you tell when you're offending somebody?
What policies and procedures could be put into place to make sure people know when they are acting inappropriately? If his church had a sexual misconduct education program in place, Frank might have been able to spot his own offensive behavior and stop it. As well, if the church had a clear policy on sexual misconduct and strongly enforced it, people would be more aware of the different forms sexual harassment can take and be less likely to make inappropriate jokes or comments. Along with these practices, it's important to create an environment where people are not uncomfortable or afraid to report sexual harassment.
Now that we've looked at sexual assault, exploitation, and harassment, let's look at an example of sexual exploitation that may not be as clear-cut or easy to spot. Sonia is a youth group leader, and this scenario occurs when she and the group are out hiking.
So did you catch the game last night, Sonia?
Oh yeah, it was really good, actually.
You know, Sonia, I've been thinking. I'm 17, I'm only 2 years younger than you. You know, maybe you want to go see a movie on Saturday?
Under the Criminal Code of Canada, it is a criminal offense for an adult in a position of authority to have a sexual relationship with a child aged 14 to adult. In this situation, the female youth leader is in a position of authority and trust, even though her authority might not seem as clear as that of a clergy person. She's young and close in age to the boy who has asked her out. But since the youth leader is in a position of authority, it would be sexual exploitation and a criminal offense if she crosses the boundary and starts a sexual relationship with the boy. What could be done immediately to stop this relationship from becoming one of sexual exploitation?
Well, I wasn't actually too much surprised. It was because I kind of knew he had a crush on me. I told him that I couldn't go out with him, but it would be wonderful that we could still go on activities with the group. I told the other youth leader, just so that somebody else is aware of the situation.
The youth leader realized that she was in a position of authority, so she had to take steps to ensure that the crush would go no further. She clearly explained the boundaries of the relationship to the boy, told another youth leader about the situation, documented it, and made sure she was never alone with the boy again. She was also prepared to have another youth leader speak with the boy if necessary. What policies and procedures could be put in place to prevent situations like this? Always have two adults present with children, even if they are in their late teens. Clergy and church wardens should randomly attend youth events. Youth leaders should document all youth outings and events. Youth leaders should also receive training in the serious issues surrounding sexual misconduct. They should be aware that it is a criminal offense for a person in a position of authority, such as themselves, to start a sexual relationship with a member of their group who is not an adult. They should also receive training on effective ways to maintain appropriate relationship boundaries with the members of their youth group.
Now here's a sexual harassment scenario that many people would not spot.
In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Amen.
And again, a special welcome, Linda. Thank you for joining us, and yes. We hope to see you next week.
Welcome, yeah. Welcome.
We got lots done.
Well, good. Yeah. Okay. That's great.
Yeah. Nice. Oh. Hi. Nice meeting.
Yes, very nice.
Nice to see you.
Nice to meet you.
I'll be back. Yeah. Bye.
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 Bye. See you later. Okay, take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Violin. Thanks
Bye,
so
nice
much.
To nice to meet you. Yeah.
In this case, the act of hugging wasn't intended to be sexual, but it involved physical contact that could be experienced as inappropriate. Remember, it is not the intention that matters. It's the effect of the actions or comments that matters. In this case, the new member made it clear that the hug was unwelcome. Therefore, the hug could be considered sexual harassment. What could be done immediately to stop this from exploding into an incident of sexual harassment?
Susan?
Hi.
Hi. I just wanted to say something about the meeting. It's a personal thing, and I just don't like being hugged.
Oh.
I don't know how else to say it. It just makes me really uncomfortable. So.
Linda, I didn't mean to make you
well,
feel
I just wanted to say something rather than.
Oh, so. I totally understand.
Okay?
Sure.
Okay.
We'll see you next week.
Okay, good. Okay. Bye-bye.
Everyone has different feelings about being touched. In some cultures, hugging and kissing are an accepted part of everyday greetings. But some people feel uncomfortable about being touched, especially by people they don't know. It's okay to say no to being hugged. It doesn't make you less loving or caring because you don't like to be hugged or touched. The reality is, you should always ask permission to touch someone else.
Well, we got together like we do every week, and normally ending our meetings, we've just all become accustomed to hugging each other. And Linda being new, after I hugged her, she came in and expressed that she was uncomfortable about it. I come from a family of huggers, and we're very touchy-feely people, and I never assumed that anyone would be uncomfortable with it. But obviously Linda had been. She caught me off guard, and now I know that not everybody feels the same way I do, obviously, and I'll think twice, possibly ask permission.
What policies and procedures could be put in place to ensure uncomfortable situations like this don't happen again? The best way to avoid these situations is to teach members of your religious community how to spot sexual harassment, and how to stop it. It's also important to teach people how to read visual signs from people who don't want to be touched. If the chairwoman had been able to read the new committee member's body language, she would have known that the woman didn't want to be hugged. On top of this valuable training and education, a sexual misconduct policy must be enforced that clearly states you must ask permission to touch someone else. It should also state that if you've been told your behavior is unwelcome, you must stop that behavior right away.
We hope the scenarios we've shown will help you prevent the three types of sexual misconduct from occurring in your religious community.
The opportunity to work in ministry is a privilege and one that we must cherish so that God's call can be fulfilled. By learning how to spot sexual harassment, sexual exploitation, and sexual abuse, and knowing how to stop it, we can affirm the goodness of human sexuality and help create places of sanctuary where people can experience the fullness of God's love.